We're going to continue the discussion accordingly and basically conclude that discussion today. So we already started talking about the LDA model as a series of progressive improvements over simple unigram model last time. And then this you can understand now, I hope. Okay. So LDA is a mixture of topics model for unigram text whose parameters are set through Bayesian learning. Now, the advantage of being able to say this is you now have all the building blocks to understand that sentence. And so I sort of remembered this, that Alfred North Whitehead said, civilization advances by extending the number of important operations that we can do without thinking about them. So if I can just say these and know what they mean, you know, that's basically what you had to do. And so presumably, you now know what is Bayesian learning, you know, unigram text, you know, mixture of topics, and you know, how basically when you're doing Bayesian learning, you need to do inference, essentially. There is no separate learning, just inference. And the inference would be over the hidden parameters, and that's what is being done in the LDA case. So the fact that you can sort of make sense of that sentence, to the extent you can make sense of that sentence, we've been successful in going through all the relevant topics. Okay. So today we'll also talk about the update rules or the Gibbs sampling rules, but upfront I'll say that actual derivation of them, I would not be doing, you know, step-by-step derivation, because to some extent, understanding those derivations requires, you know, being reasonably familiar with doing integrations over Dirichlet distributions. Okay. However, and that's why that reference. So those of you who are who are interested, you should follow the description in that paper that I mentioned. I would, however, make you believe that if only you put the time in doing those, you know, following that derivation, it's not magic, because it just comes from all the things that you know of, which is how Gibbs sampling is done over baselines. Okay, that's when we get there. But let me go back and discuss what we were doing last time. I'll let you review what we were doing last time. By the way, actually, I might want to just start from here and say we started talking about LSA, and that the advantage of LSA is that essentially both the topics, both the documents and the words become represented in a lower dimensional, in a different space, the topic space. Okay. By the way, when I wrote a couple of minor things, when I wrote that I do DD, the document term matrix, into document factor and factor term matrix, right? And this is sort of factorization. One of the things is you don't necessarily look for exact factorization. This is equality sign is what I used last time. Most of the time what you're doing is you do approximate factors. That means find two matrices of the form document factor, factor term, such that multiplication of those gives you a matrix, of course, of the size document by term. Okay, but that matrix is somehow close to this matrix. And the normal idea in matrices is you'll say that another matrix which is of the same size is close to this in terms of the distance between the matrices. So if you have Aij here, A dash ij here, because this is exactly the same size matrices, you can consider Aij minus A dash ij, square it, sum over all the elements. Okay, and then minimize them. Okay, that's what basically most factorizations do. Try to find two matrices such that this is actually called Frobenius norm. Frobenius norm, which is basically a particular distance metric between two matrices. Okay, so you're trying to find factors such that this norm is minimized. If it's exact factoring, this would be zero. That's the basic idea. Okay, and the SVD, actually the singular value decomposition, provides a very nice systematic way of getting different levels of approximation. And that was this picture, because what happens in the case of SVD is upfront it gives an exact factorization. If you multiply this by this by this, you get exact matrix back, the original matrix back. But then you can improve the approximation, you can make it approximate by ignoring some of the singular values. Now this looks kind of weird. Why would I want to go from exact factorization to approximate factorization? Well, if you go with the exact factorization, then essentially the dimensionality, the number of, so if there are 15 documents and 25 words, then the number of singular values would be at least 15. You see what I'm saying? That means you didn't really reduce both documents and words into a much smaller space. Okay, whereas, so in this particular case, for example, there is 10 documents and 6 words, and so actually there is 6 different singular values. Okay, that's why you get the exact, and then if you use that, and you can basically consider FF times TF as one matrix and DF as the other matrix, and you will get your two matrices, for example. And the idea of improving the dimensions, to reduce the dimensionality, to actually make sure that the documents and words are in a smaller space, what you can do is you essentially look at, one of the advantages of SVD, it turns out, is it actually puts these dimensions in the orders of importance. Okay, so you can just, if you must start removing dimensions, you will start from here, and then this, and then this, and then this. So if I just want two dimensions, those are your two dimensions. Okay, and then you can reconstruct the matrix with those two dimensions, and you will get a matrix of the same size as this. I wish I showed it here. The same size as this, but it will have slightly different numbers. And it turns out there's great theory which shows that of all the two rank matrices in the world, which are of size 10 by 6, the one that I reconstruct this way would be the one that will minimize that. Okay, that's what LSA tells you. Okay, but the important thing, of course, is by reducing the dimensionality, you are able to see both the documents and the terms in the same space. This space is the latent space. This is the factor space. Okay, this is what we are doing. And one of the things, of course, is in the case of matrix view of this whole problem, the factors wind up being linear combinations of documents and words. Okay, so documents have their own dimensions, words have their own dimensions, and basically the factors are just linear combinations of the original dimensions. Okay, and so when you come here, and this is written here, so if you want to provide a probabilistic version of this, unlike LSA factors, which are linear combinations over terms, PLSA, I should call it PLSA here, PLSA topics are really multinomial distributions over terms. So they are distributions over terms. This guy would be, an LSA factor would be 4 times database minus 2 times computer science plus 3 times structure. That's basically what those factors would look like. From a probabilistic interpretation, you can think of topics essentially, and you don't know what to say. If you say 4 times database plus 3 times computer science minus 2 times structure, you don't have any clear understanding of what are you talking about, these new dimensions. They're just some random linear combinations of the old dimensions. Okay? Whereas here you think of topics essentially as multinomial distributions over terms, which is what we have been looking at. Okay? And you can essentially compute, and that will have a probabilistic semantics, and you will have a probabilistic a plate model. And I also talked about the fact that you can be both asymmetric, the way this is written, or symmetric version of the PLSA. Yes, sir.
So on the equation on the right hand side, is the arrow between Z and D reversed unless these two equations are not equal to each other, right? Because
P, C, T, and D D is PC and D, isn't it? This part is PC and D.
Yeah.
And this part is again PC and D.
But here, like, Z is the parent of D also. Then only we can get PD.
No. All I am asking is, don't even think of the... If you look at this and just use the Bayes rule, it doesn't matter what the structure is. Notice that if you view this equation this way, then you will write a different Bayes network. You would write a network where Z would be the parent of both D and W. Here, you wrote D to be the parent of Z, which is the parent of W. This is a symmetric version. That would be symmetric version. Yes?
How would we represent the symmetric version in the plane notation?
How would you represent? You would basically have to start writing Z. I mean, I'm not sure that I can write it right now, but I would think you'd have to have Z, D, W, and I need to put the right plates. You need to put the right plates, I'm not quite sure. But that's the symmetric version. So you wind up having Z being, for specific number of documents and words, it's very easy to see, okay? Again, this most people, when they look at PLSA, if you read the original papers, they'll use this asymmetric notation. But and in this paper, the LDA paper argues that the asymmetry is one of its negative points of PLSA, and so LDA is better. But then some other people essentially point out that you can actually view this, I mean, equivalently, you can view this as a symmetric version. And if that's the only problem, you could solve it. That's why I said in the class, in the last time, that the better way to think about this is LDA does Bayesian learning over the PLSA model. As against doing maximum likelihood estimation. Okay. And so we were looking at some examples of LDA. So by the way, first of all, this is LDA model. And there are two different plate notations, one in the slides and one in the paper. I am hoping that you're not too confused by it. Essentially, both of this particular, the tricky part is this beta issue. Okay. The interesting thing is the word takes the probability that this word would be, let's say, cat, depends both on what is the topic supposed to be for this word. Let's say this Z tells you that the topic is supposed to be 4. Then you need to go and see for topic 4, what is the distribution, probability distribution, over all the words. And that's what this is supposed to tell you. So the beta carrier, this is basically giving you k different multinomial distributions for the k different topics. Okay? And basically, W needs both of those to set itself. So in fact, all it requires, even though you get k different distributions from here, it will only use the distribution corresponding to the parent. So if this says 7, I only look at 7th value. 7th distribution here. Okay, so that's basically, it's written here as this is showing that there actually are k different distributions, and each distribution itself is being, has a prior, a Dirichlet prior. Okay, and the same thing is being said here, without showing the plate notation. Multiple questions, yeah.
I think I'm confused, but in the video, the professor said that BK is a topic. He repeatedly said BK is a topic.
No, beta K, theta D is the topic proportion, Z is the topic, and beta is the word distribution in the topic. That's the only way it makes sense.
I will see again.
Okay.
If all of your data is, say, issues of magazines about cats,
okay.
Would you run into a situation where all of your topics have a high probability of having the most probable word being cat? Like, is that okay that
one... No, I didn't get your question.
So, or if you think about stop words, mm-hmm. A stop word would have high probability despite the topic.
Yeah.
So if you list the top 10 topics, it seems like you could run into a situation where the top 10 topic words for each topic are all the same. Is that actual problem in practice?
that depends to some extent, actually, let's see, that's a good question. I think that depends to some extent on what sort of priors you wind up putting. And these eta and alpha are the Dirichlet hyperparameters in this case. Okay? And it depends on what sort of hyperparameters there are. And that's what we discussed last time about the requirement for sparsity. Okay? And to get sparsity, you essentially wind up needing the sum of, I mean, they basically use Dirichlet priors, which are all symmetric, to make life simple. That means it's like alpha 1 to alpha k. If you have, for this, the Dirichlet prior would be essentially there are k distributions here, but each distribution over is over v different parameters. Because v is the number of words, okay? And so you would need, alpha 1 all the way, and eta 1 all the way to eta v, and you make them all equal. Now the question is, if the sum is reduced, then they will become more sparse. That's the point he makes, yes.
So, specific to this question, in the tutorial, the professor says when he does this topic model for gesto documents, they remove the stop words. All the words that appear in more than 90% of the documents, they remove them. And that's
so the point is that you can do those, you can do a whole bunch of additional things before you get here. Okay. But part of the reason I was hoping you guys can play with the LDA examples, is you can actually figure this out yourself. You can set some examples and see. But one reasonable thing to do in IR pretty much is to always remove the stop words. But then the stop word situation is tricky. What if, the corpus is made up of half computer science and half religion? Okay, and then Jesus Christ would be a stop word for half of the word things, and data structure would be a stop word for the other half. Now what do you do? Okay, so it is true that if a word occurs in every place, then essentially it has no discriminative power, and most of these models will be able to capture that. Okay, it's certainly the classification model will capture it right away because it does. Those words are no longer discriminating between the topics. Okay. Okay, so that's, and then this is just the unrolled result. So you should be able to see that although there are little multiple different ways, this is essentially the same as that. And the tricky, the crazy part, of course, is you're sort of using the topic value to index into the specific distribution you are supposed to use. And that distribution might say word cat is occurring with probability 10 power minus 5. So then you toss a coin which comes heads with 10 power minus 5, and if it actually comes heads, then you put cat. Actually, in fact, what you really do is you don't decide whether or not it's a cat, you just decide what this word is. Okay? So you know the seventh topic, so you look at the word distribution for the seventh topic, and then you get your v-dimensional coin and toss it. V-dimensional coin whose probabilities of coming any dimension are actually set exactly with respect to that multinomial and toss it, which you can do, obviously, using your random
one. Sorry, one more question. You're saying you know your topic 7 and then you flip your is it topic, you know your topic 7 or you know your topic 7 with 0.3 probability?
No, so that's the probabilities of the topics are given by theta. You sample theta to get the exact topic.
Okay.
So this way, so basically, this is the thing. So this is the probabilities for, these are the topic mixtures. This one might say 0.5, 0.5. This one might say 0.25, 0.75. This one might say 0.75, 0.25. And from these, you are selecting this, you are actually sampling the topics. So you get an exact topic. Once you know the exact topic, you know from these distributions what is the word probabilities. And so you sample from that word probabilities, you sample everything. Okay? And in the generative case, you go like this, essentially. And of course, in inverting the generative model, which is what you might have to do, you have all the words, you need to compute the theta and theta and c. Okay, but you need to understand the generative model before you can do the other part. Now, this is the minimum you need to do. Okay, And another way of putting it is, I would be very unhappy if you don't even understand generative model. Okay, basically they're done with this course. No. If you did not completely understand the collapse Gibbs sampling, I can live with you. You know. But if you still didn't understand how to generate and how to actually play this model out and generate words, then we are in trouble. Okay. So again, this is this guy's thing essentially. He actually did write it in the wrong, different way.
Yeah, he was continuously speaking this as topics. And in the last
No, this is still, there are k different topics, and for each topic there is a distribution.
Yeah, and in the last slide, the presentation that you have done, in that also each beta 1 should be there differently. If you are putting one beta
that,
to all...
That's true, this one, right?
This one,
yeah,
mistake,
but
yeah.
That's true. Okay, that's basically the... So this represents this.
Yes.
Better than this.
Yes.
But the reality actually is that, remember, you need actually, for each word, it does not know, until it finds one of its parents, it won't know which distribution it will need.
Yes.
So you really need to carry all the k distributions along, until you figure out who your parent is, in which case then you'll pick that.
So after this representation, we actually visualize that there is actually need of plate.
Yes.
We are not.
Yeah, but not only that, but this one is a weird plate scenario. That's why, you know, in their own paper, in the original paper, they don't put a plate for this, for example. Okay. The other thing, let me see, one more thing is. Okay, I'll get back to this. Let's go back to the example that we played with last time. So this is essentially, I just mentioned this in the last class. So you have here a scenario, I'm going forward. Suppose I have decided that there are only two topics, category one and category two, and these are my only words, and I have decided these are the probabilities of the words given the topic. Okay, then essentially I can generate, given the topic, I can generate words. Now, different documents will have different topic mixtures. Okay, so here is a document which has topic mixture 0, 1. That means it has 0 of the first topic and 1 of the second topic. This has 0.25, 0.75, and 0.5, and so on. These are the topic mixtures. Now, given these topic mixtures, given, to get the first word, I'll go here, select a topic, sample a topic. Since it's 0, 1, I'll always sample topic 1, the second topic as the topic. Right, and then I go back here and I remember for the topic 2, I'll never get these words because I put them as 0. And so I'll only get one of these and they occur with equal probability. Okay, so this is basically, these are generated by sampling, and this is how these documents would look. And don't read anything in the order of the words, because the order doesn't mean anything. We only think in terms of bags of words. Okay, this was more of a just fully topic 2 document. This is like a 0.25 topic 1 and 0.75 topic 2 document, and so on. And to the extent you can see the difference, then, you know, basically you can figure out what's going on here. Now, this, to the extent you can't see much of a difference between these three, it's easy enough to probably see the difference between this and this, because one of them is one topic, the other is the other topic. In a two-topic scenario, sparsity of topics almost doesn't make too much sense, right? It's either, you know, either it's 50% of the topics are in your document, or 100% of your topics are in your document with non-zero probabilities. Okay, so in fact, the whole sparsity part doesn't make, for this case, if you are having trouble figuring out what exactly is the difference between these three kinds of documents just by staring at them, you are not alone. It's like saying, you know, I'm putting just slightly different non-zero fractions of all the topics. Okay, LDA allows this. However, I also argued, and we also talked about the fact that you would like to hope that actually the individual documents only have very small fraction, greater than one, but small fraction of all the topics. then they will actually differ from each other significantly based on the topic proportion. Okay, so that's the scenario. Now, what you will wind up having to do in the LDA learning part, I mean the Bayesian learning part, is you will just be given these. You have to play this back. Instead of going forward, you have to play this back. You'll be given this. So then you need to figure out for each of these words what is the most likely topic it is coming from. Okay, and for each of the topics, what's the most likely distribution of words for them? And those two things you need to figure out. That's what is reconstruction. Okay? And then going back here, which I said I will look at this slide once. So first of all, if you are talking about a model like this, you are always interested in, you know, just as for the naive unigram model, for example, we talked about the probability distribution of finding a sequence, a bag of words. Okay, given a bag of words, what's the probability that you would have found it? You know, this is a big deal for generative models. The way you see a generative model is representative of the data is if the data has high likelihood. Data has high likelihood given this generative model. Okay, so now how do you compute the likelihood of the data given this model? Okay, in that particular case, of course, alpha and beta, you know, alpha and beta are the hyperparameters for him. Actually, it should be eta because this is not the picture. This I took from the JMLR paper where beta is kept outside. Okay, so his meaning, he actually means alpha and beta in this case. Okay, but you can understand what's going on here. For the word, you know, you're trying to compute the probability of the words given the parameters, and to do that, you have to marginalize everything else out. Okay, so you first take the joint distribution of all the variables, and then you start integrating out or summing out any of the variables that you don't want, okay? So essentially, you're summing out the z, and you're also summing out the theta. Okay, that will give you the probability distribution over the words, and then probability distribution over the entire document corpus. Since each document is a set of words, then you multiply the probability distribution for each of the document's words. Probability for all of them, and then that will get this. Okay, and so to say a document corpus likelihood given this model would be this. Okay, and the tricky part, of course, is there are continuous parameters here, which is what you get rid of using the collapse Gibbs sampling. Okay, but that's basically so. The two parts here is one, first of all, given a Bayes network, you can compute always. If this is the other thing I want you to be able to understand. If I give a network, even a plate model, and I ask you what is the probability of a complete data sample, this is already not a complete data sample. This is actually marginal over just the words. If I were to tell you what is the, you know, if I were to go with, suppose I were to say what is the probability of mathematics being from topic one, knowledge one, knowledge being from topic two, and research being from topic one, and so on. So I give you the values not only of the words, but also of the hidden variables, or the other variables. Then you should be able to just compute the probability by multiplying out using the Bayes network independent assumptions. That much you should be able to do. And what happened in this case, you started from there and you marginalized certain variables, the z variable and the theta for machines. Okay. The other thing is this picture is essentially saying, this picture, I don't know whether you can even say it, that the topics themselves are points in the simplex over words. Okay, and documents are points in this topic simplex. So in some sense, essentially, documents are now in a smaller dimensional space of topics, but the topics themselves live in the higher dimensional space of words. Okay? And that's the same point that was being made in the PLSA thing, that essentially the factors now are distributions over words. Okay. One thing, by the way, I want you to remember, and I will mention it again later on, is the thing about Dirichlet distribution is the posterior would be also Dirichlet. Okay? And the other thing to remember is the gamma function. The one little thing you need to remember about gamma function is it is a continuous version factorial. Okay? So if you ever see somewhere, you know, something like gamma n plus 1 by gamma n, and then later on they make it into n, that's allowed, right? Because by definition, gamma n plus 1 is m gamma n. That's the factorial definition.
Factorial n or n?
No, gamma is what?
It should be n factorial n.
No, gamma n plus 1 is not exactly, gamma n plus 1 would be factorial n. So factorial n is n times factorial n minus 1. So the gamma function is connected to factorial but shifted by 1. Okay. So gamma n plus 1 would be, if n is an integer, gamma n plus 1 would be n factorial. That's all you need to remember. Because there are places, I'll be able to show you. I mean, if you are going through the derivation of this guy, at some point of time, he comes up with the probability distribution in terms of a dense product over, you know, gamma functions. Okay, and then next step, it becomes just counts. Where did the gammas go away? Okay, well, because gammas will go away like this. If you have anything like this, it will go away. That's what you need to figure out. That in fact, they're getting canceled because they are essentially factorial functions. Okay, that's all you need to really remember about gamma functions. The second thing that you want to remember about the entire Dirichlet distribution is, that's something that we already mentioned. One is that we use symmetric priors. In most LDM models use symmetric priors, and the sum of the hyperparameters can, you know, sort of decides the sparsity of the topics. Okay. And these are actually the pictures showing three different Dirichlet distributions of three dimensions. Let's see. Okay, now before I go into, why did I get here? Before I go into Dirichlet distribution, I wanted to do two more things before I go into them. So this is the one that I was mentioning. I'm assuming that people have seen it, but just to do. Yeah, okay. So this one is basically you did here, you did LDA with just exactly six topics. No, actually seven topics, right? Topic zero to topic six. And then for each paper, they essentially are pointing out the topics that are occurring in it and the words from those topics. Okay. And the advantage of this is, as I mentioned last time, I mean, how many of you actually played with this? Okay, the rest of you are in the wrong class. You know, it's not just me sending mails, you should also open them as well. Anyway, so if you play with this, then essentially you can use the topics to browse. So if you like this paper, and you like this paper particularly, let's say, because of these red words, that means you are interested in topic one, because the red words come from topic one. So if you want more papers like that, you go, look for papers in terms of topic one. So that's the advantage of this topic-oriented view of the document corpus. And again, remember that each of these documents now is really a distribution, a specific distribution over these seven topics. So I can go ahead and say each document is a point in seven-dimensional space. Actually, it's a point in the seven-dimensional simplex. Okay, and there are many, many approaches that depend on doing similarity computations by doing distances between points in Euclidean space. Okay, so now you would argue that, well, instead of trying to find distance between the documents using vector similarity or any other document-oriented methods, I'll find the distance in terms of these topic points. Okay, and essentially, in the JMLR paper, the whole bunch of experiments that they do, for example, when they do the collaborative filtering experiments, what they wind up doing is they're using these alternative coordinates, okay, the lower dimensional coordinates to do actual filtering, okay? And you could do this, in fact, they did it for LDA, but it was an idea that was known beforehand. In general, dimensional reduction is done exactly to allow a newer space in which probably the points are better represented so that the noise is thrown out. Okay, so you could have done LSA. Oh, in fact, collaborative filtering, the biggest example of collaborative filtering is what? I assume a lot of you know collaborative filtering, even if you didn't take IR courses. I mean, if you ever got to Amazon and you buy a book, they'll try to sell you another book. They say, other people who bought these kinds of books bought this book too, so why don't you buy it? That's collaborative filtering. In Netflix, you take a couple of movies, they'll try to show you one more movie and say, you know, people like this set of movies, liked also this movie. That's collaborative filtering. Okay, so what they're trying to see is, in their case, so if you take something like Netflix collaborative filtering scenario, you have, instead of, so basically you have a big matrix, which is movies, users. Users, movies. Okay? And so users are vectors in the space of movies, movies are vectors in the space of users. And you can compute the similarity between two movies by taking the vectors, the corresponding user vectors, and see how similar they are. You can compute the similarity between users by taking their vector representation in terms of the movies and seeing how close they are. And the normal idea of collaborative filtering is, if you are the current users, you know, current user you see, then they will take your vector and see which of the user vectors here are the most close to you. So let's compute, let's say, you know, k users that are close to you. And then having figured that out, then they'll say, well, those guys have seen movies which you haven't seen yet. So why don't you see them? Because they are your soulmates. You just don't know they exist. We know it in our big database. And they like these movies, so they read this, you know, you are, watch these movies. That's what collaborative filtering is. Now, basically, user movies matrix is sort of like document term matrix, okay? And so if I can put documents and terms in a third space of factors, I can put users and movies in a third space of factors too. A lower dimensional space where both users and movies are vectors. Okay, how would you do it? You can do LSA on the user movie matrix. In fact, Netflix prize was won by people who did a sort of regularized LSA. Okay, the LDA paper was written in 2003. The Netflix prize finally wound down 3 years back. So 2009. Okay, and by 2009, basically the best collaborative filtering was not LDA. Okay, of course, this is always a moving target. So as of the time of a JMLR paper, straightforward use of LSA to do collaborative filtering and using LDA to do collaborative filtering, they found LDA is better. Otherwise, they would have put that as an experiment in the paper. They would have put some other experiment. But in the end, actually, a variation of LSA actually won the Netflix prize. Okay. Netflix prize, by the way, actually was, how many of you know the Netflix prize? Okay, so Netflix essentially realized that the cheapest way to get my work done is to not hire people, but to say to the researchers, we'll give you like $10, and we'll give you a prize, like a certificate, you know? And then, of course, researchers are actually being, you know, hired by universities and Bell Labs, etc., who don't actually see what the researchers are doing. And they were essentially spending all their time, waking hours, solving Netflix problems. Okay, wherein where basically they took essentially they held out some data and then they gave out the user the rest of it. They gave out the user movie matrices and then they essentially asked people to predict whether or not certain movies would be liked by certain users, and they that was the test data. They compared it to their test data. This was actually, they didn't predict themselves. They actually know whether or not those users finally watch the movies and put a 4-star or 5-star review. Okay, and they use that to figure out whether your recommendations were good. And you know, of course, I think a bunch of people from AT&T won. At least the first time. I don't know the second time who else won. Yeah.
Did you know that they don't actually, Netflix didn't actually end up using the winning algorithm? They decided it was too complicated.
Yeah, that would be surprised. That's an interesting point. I didn't know that actually. But I think they also had trouble in terms of privacy issues, and so they canceled the third version.
Yeah.
Third version of the thing. Okay. People are always whining if you give away their information. I don't know why. But anyway, so the thing, of course, is that collaborative filtering basically involves dimensional redirection. LDA can be seen also as a way of doing dimensional redirection. The thing to remember is, in normal LSA, the new space is just a linear combination of old space. In this, the new space is basically just topics which are still points in the word simplex. And documents are points in the topic simplex, which means they're also points in the word simplex. Okay? So that aspect of the, you know, dimensional reduction is very important to keep in mind regarding the LDA. The other thing that I wanted to talk to you about LDA, which they actually make a point in David Bly talks about this. This is this whole issue of why do you care more about generative models than non-generative models? To some extent, you won't understand this too much unless you realize that even in probabilistic modeling, even in statistical modeling, there are two types of models called generative models and discriminative models. Okay, generative model, I actually used to have my slides about it, but I forgot to put them in. You can say that in general, if you have, let's say, x1, x2, xn, y1, y2, yk, let's say, are the total number of variables. You can say anything you want to say about all these variables if you have a joint on all of these together. A generative model tries to learn the joint over all the variables. However, it is possible that in some application, x1 up to xn are input variables, and you barely care the connections between them. You never really try to guess the input variable values. You're always interested in guessing the output variable values, y1 to yk. You see what I'm saying? In such a case, then you would just want to learn y given x. And you want to just learn the probability distribution y given x. Now notice, if I know p y given x times px, I have px. This is generative. This is discriminative. Discriminative models basically learn the conditional distribution. Generative models learn the entire joint. Which one is learning more stuff? Come on, I don't need
question.
Generative model, right? Because if I have a generative, if I only have this, I still need this to get this. Okay, now what happens? Why is this? On the other hand, one might ask, if you will never ever need to know about the input, okay, then in essence, if you learned this, then you are wasting your effort learning this part. Because learning this involves learning this as well as this, one way of thinking about it. Now what is p of x? That is the dependencies between the input values. You don't need to learn them if you learn discriminative models. Okay? For every learning technique that is generative, there is a variation of it that is discriminative that tries to get by with less amount of work because it learns fewer parameters. Okay? In particular, for example, suppose you have a scenario. The obvious scenario here is, suppose I have a bunch of records. It's a credit card transactions. And they are all basically, each row is a credit card transaction, okay? And these are the attributes of the transactions. You know, who did it? What is the dollar amount? Where was it done? What is the merchant, what is the item type, etc., etc. And then there is one other column called, is it fraudulent? Okay, I would say these are x1, etc., up to x100. And this is just y1. If you have a whole bunch of data about credit card transactions, all you really care about is guessing whether or not a given transaction is a fraudulent transaction. If that's all you want, you, from a statistical point of view, you are better off learning P, Y given x1 to x100. If, on the other hand, you learn a generative model, you would have learned P, x1 to x100 and Y, which involves learning this, of course, which involves learning both these, as well as that. And when you do that, when you involve learning X, then you will actually be able to realize, for example, that there are connections between these attributes. It turns out that the high dollar value is connected to the item being bought. For example, these attributes are not completely independent. They are correlated. And your model will figure out those correlations. So now here is the interesting thing. So why would anybody want to learn a generative model? Anybody in the industry want to learn a generative model if they can get by with a discriminative model? They don't. Most of the time they learn discriminative models. If all you need is a simple classification, you learn a discriminative model. The beauty of the generative model, on the other hand, is you can run it either which way. If you get the output, if you give the output, you can compute the input. So for example, if I learned the generative model, okay, then I can actually generate a representative space of credit card transactions, including their input values and their fraudulent status. A discriminative model, I can't do anything. I can only tell, if you give me something, I can tell you whether or not it's a fraudulent transaction. Okay, now LDA is a generative model. Everything we discussed here is a generative model. This is one way we are different from a normal machine learning class. Normal machine learning class, first we'll try to do discriminative models. Because, you know, why do more work than what you're supposed to do? Okay. One of the advantages of generative models, one of the reasons why people like it, there are many good advantages actually, one of which is that they're almost like Lego blocks. You can take one generative model, add another generative model on top of it, another generative model on top of it, and make, you know, more and more complex generative models. Almost as if you're building Lego block structures. Okay? And LDA, being a generative model, has this property. I mean, in the paper and in the talk, they make it sound as if LDA only has this property, nobody else has it. All generative models have this property. It's just a property of generative models, okay? Now, of course, that's how the pictures are shown, that there are lots and lots of generative models here, and, you know, pieces of which happen to be LDA. And I have decided that actually, rather than look at this picture. I will show you a couple of slides from Yuheng's work. Yuheng is the guy who's looking at your project, which if you complete the project, LDA project. So what he was doing was he was trying to, there's a paper on AAAI this year on this. He was trying to figure out, you know, if you have a transcript of some debate or some address, public address, and then there is a whole bunch of tweets that are going on at the same time. Don't ask me whether or not this problem is interesting. Some of you think it's a great problem. Some of you may think, why are you doing this? But it's a problem that's quite different from anything else that we discussed earlier. So you have tweets here. You have, you know, the transcript of the address, right? Now, what I want to know is which part of this, you know, there's a tweet, and you read it, and you'll say, well, oh, this must be about this part. This must be about this part. And some of these tweets are about the entire event. Now, I mean, I don't know, I mean, I'm not necessarily a Web 4.0 person. I hope some of you are. And that many of these public events now, upfront, go ahead and give a hashtag so that you can start tweeting, you know, and then with respect to what's going on in that event. And then, so somebody can actually look at these tweets and see whether public is enjoying it, not enjoying it, whether they are happy about certain things, sad about certain things. What are the sentiments about the opinions expressed, and so on and so forth. It's a useful thing to do. It's like one of these, you know, things that, since the data is available, you can do this. All great, okay? For all of those to be done, what you need is some connection between the tweet and the part of the transcript that tweet refers to. Right? Okay, had they said, by the way, I'm about to say something about what happened between 3.01 seconds and 3.04 seconds, then it's easy. But they won't say. Okay, and the tweets are not even necessarily in the exact order of the transcript, because sometimes you go back and, you know, say something about, you know, something that happened earlier, all sorts of fun stuff. So it's like, you know, this is a pretty complicated problem. Now, the question, of course, is what you want to do is, can I do this automatically? Can I make this connection between tweets and the transcript automatically? And a way of doing it would be that you can imagine both the, so first of all, you have to understand that this entire transcript is probably made up of segments. Each segment is itself some sort of a topic distribution. I'm sort of priming you to think in the LDA way, but that's a reasonable way of saying there's a, for one segment they are talking about some things, and another segment they're talking about some things else, and so on. Now the segments are not known upfront. We can figure out as we read stuff, we know how the segments are changing. But your machine only gets this document and these tweets. You can easily crawl these tweets and get them. And then you want to make this connection. Okay. So basically you want to find, first of all, automatically generate segments and find segment which is topically referred to by a particular tweet. And in some sense what you're doing, one way of thinking about it is if the tweets and the segments are basically points in a topic simplex, then you can look at the similarity between, the distance between those points as a way of aligning. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay? If you want to do that, clearly we are talking about topics, we're talking something must be like, you know, close to LDA sort of model can be used. And so a generative model tells a story about how the data is generated. A discriminative model has no story to tell. It's all work, no stories. So if you don't like stories and you just want work done, which is what all industries are about, they just say go with logistic regression. Which, by the way, is the discriminative version of naive Bayes classifier. Okay, so anyway, that part, you know, if you don't get it, that's fine. I'm just saying, for some of you who might know this, you know, there are variations, as I said, there are variations for every generative version, there is a discriminative version. And there's very interesting questions as to when would you go for discriminative versus generative. But one simple thing is, if you want to tell a story, then generative model is your way. Now stories can be embedded in other stories. I'm going in, you know, hyper metaphors. And generative models can be embedded in other generative models. That's the idea. Okay, so here is the story that you had wanted to tell as to how this whole thing came about. And then you invert it, you will get the model. Okay, so his idea is that the event is transpiring, there are segments that are being generated. Now the segment, there is some random variable with respect to which you decide whether to start a new segment or not. So you sample that random variable, if it says start a new segment, you start a new segment. And if you are in the same segment, then there is a particular topic mix for that segment. Whenever you change a new segment, you then have to go back and ask the topic variable, give me a new topic mix. Okay, that allows you to change the topics between segments. So that's how the topic, the transcript is generated. Now, how are the tweets generated? Tweets basically can be, according to history, they can be about the entire transcript. You know, they just, you know, hey, did you know that there's this debate going on? That can you believe that Obama said the following thing about Israel, which could be much more specific than the entire debate. So there would be some variable which you sample to decide whether or not you're going to say something general or something specific. And if you decided to say something specific, then you pick a segment and basically you generate a tweet with respect to that. So with the using the same topic. That's my story. I'm going to stick to it. Okay? Now, if I have this story, then the question is, can I have a plate-oriented LDA model? Plate-oriented model, LDA model, okay? So, it turns out, let's skip over this, you can always skip over this, and this story corresponds to this model. Okay, this looks obviously quite busy. I made it bigger. Okay, it still looks busy, but you should be able to see, where is LDA in this?
There are two LDAs.
Yes. Right? At least you see one LDA here. Okay, so this big model, essentially, it's a statistical model, it's a plate model, and it's telling the story that I wanted it to tell. And here is basically the event part of the model. Here is the tweet part of the model. If they were just different, then everything is fine, but they basically get connected. Because tweets and events are connected. You know, tweets are made, you know, when you're making a specific tweet, then you are presumably making it because of the segment that is under consideration. So this guy connects the words there to words here. So that makes it joint. Okay, now the rest of it, it's just an LDA model. It's a bigger LDA model. Okay, so for example, in this particular case, this is telling you whether or not you're going to start a new segment. Okay, and this, the rest of it, once you start a new segment, that's like a new document in this area. You know, each segment is a document. And then the rest of it essentially is the LDA for the documents that you know. And the topic mix was coming to LDA, remember the distributions? It's just that it's the same topic mix will also go to the tweets. If the tweets are segment-specific. If they're not segment-specific, then here, if you come here, then there is a another variable which sort of decides whether you're going to tweet about the entire event or about a specific segment. And if you're doing over the entire event, then there is a specific distribution just for the entire event. That's about overall the world. What do you feel like saying about the world? If you're saying something about the segment, then you must follow the same segment distributions. That's the way you lock these things. Now, clearly, this is a bigger model, but you know, you are able to just embed what you know from the LDA into the bigger model. That's one way of understanding what they were saying. These are like Lego blocks. And you can put this whole thing in something else. And you can tell a more complicated story. Just a second. Okay, yes.
Programming environment where you can just build these blocks real quick, or do you
want to take
a model?
So basically, right now, even there is a programming environment, there are no papers. There's just industries. Right now, it's still not, in fact, there are two points. Point one is currently no. Okay? And I'm not surprised that you asked because, you know, I mean, this guy, by the way, is an industrial engineering background, and so you know, if you just have a substrate and everybody writes programs in that substrate, then things will be fine. Okay, now one of the very interesting directions right now is what is called probabilistic programming. At the very leading edge. Okay, so this basically there must be a program for this. Yeah, this is a program. Okay, so this is happening. You can still catch the flight and come back for Monday's class. This is just happening on Friday and Saturday in Reno. Bill Cushing is actually going out there. So there is a bunch of people who are trying to see whether or not whether you can generate like general programming models where you write stuff in some higher level language, things get compiled into these sorts of models. That's a very reasonable thing to do. There are there are at least subsets of these programming languages. The bigger things don't exist yet. Okay? That's a very good point, and in fact, that's this one, this particular entire set of people are exactly interested in doing this sort of thing. Okay?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, can't be a very simple model like PFIDF be sufficient for this?
A very simple model like PFIDF will always be sufficient for everything. Truly. Okay? So there was this point long back, somebody said that the second best way of doing anything is to use neural networks. Okay, this was at the time neural networks was the biggest fad. It's again becoming big fad enough now. That, you know, if you don't want to understand how things have to be done, then just do it as a neural network. Okay, it's always going to be the second best way at least. Maybe there's a better way. And then some people will say that the third best way of doing anything is to write it as a genetic program. And so you can decide whichever area you don't like and say that's the second or third best way. Okay, and so TF-IDF is always the 14th best way of doing anything. Okay. So, and naive-Bayes classifier is always the 17th best way of doing any possible learning algorithm. And that's why Google does it. And in fact, you should do that. You know, you should, basically, if you come up with the very best solution, then what will you do next year? You have to come up with a bad solution, submit it as the version one, and then do blah, 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 and then version two, slightly worse solution, slightly better, and so on. Okay, so the answer is yes, TF-IDF will work. And but this should be obvious to you if you just read the JMLR papers, and then you notice that they describe, you know, it's not enough to say LDA works. They have to say it works better than all the obvious approaches, other obvious approaches. The other obvious approaches include TF-IDF, they do that, bag of words model, they do LSA, and they say compared to all of them, they still do well. At least in 2003, that's why they got to publish their paper. Do you see what I'm saying? Yes, you can do it with TF-IDF, but the performance won't be good enough. And in fact, if you read Yu-Heng's paper, essentially he not only says he has this joint model, he also says, for example, this much is not needed. I mean, I would say between TF-IDF and somewhere here, I could say, why should I do segmentation as part of my model? Why can't I assume somebody gave me the segments? And maybe use somebody else's approach to do the segmentation. So he actually shows as one of his experiments that segments that are learned this way are better than the automatic segmentation. Which is not surprising because there is some sort of an interesting way in which the tweets will change as the segments change. So you get extra piece of information. But you have to show that to get a paper. To talk about the paper here, I don't need to show anything. Okay? So TF-IDF will work worse than his approach. Otherwise, he wouldn't have had a publication. No. That. But if you join Google, by God, try TF-IDF first on MapCar, on MapReduce architecture. And you will keep a job for 2 more days, and then you do the next one. That's the reasonable thing. Okay. Then furthermore, although I would not, I haven't gotten to the collapse Gibbs sampling, you know, so for this bigger model, it turns out all you need to do to actually compute the Bayesian posterior is, again, you know, come up with one of the reasonable approximate inference methods. So he actually, you know, in that paper, just, you know, he extended the Gibbs sampling for this bigger model, which will look almost, I mean, if you have seen the Gibbs sampling stuff in the paper, you know, they look like, again, counts. Okay, it's just different sets of counts, including counts in terms of words occurring in the number of segments, words occurring in the number of tweets, and so on. Okay, and the last thing is he actually played, after he wrote this paper, actually, the presidential debate occurred, the two presidential debates occurred, and so this one essentially is showing that, in fact, he can actually show by analyzing results that, you know, for example, there are a lot more tweets about the big word. In fact, after a while, people just thought of the first debate as just about big word. I don't know if people were sleeping or not, but there was a little thing that this guy said about, you know, I like big word, but I will still cut the funding for, you know, PBS. And you know what happens if you say that. You will not be the president of the United States. You know, we already know that. But anyway, so that led to a lot of tweets about that. And so, in fact, after figuring out this alignment, he can actually see which segment corresponded to those tweets. And he can start making these kinds of connections. I mean, this is just sort of showing that that approach can do that. But once you actually make the alignment, you can do all sorts of things. Alignment winds up being like the substrate on which you can do lots of things. For example, you can say, is, you know, if this is a policy, this is a debate, this is a public address about, let's say, Middle East policy as well as taxes, and if all the tweets about the taxes were negative and all the tweets about Middle East policy were positive, then you would like to know that. Right now, New York Times people read it and say, you know, this is the news analysis. And they're right. Okay, now you can automate it. So one of the advantages of being a computer science person is not only, I mean, you will eventually automate everybody's job, the last being your own job. And then all of us will be, I think I mentioned this, we'll all be in this valley world up there, you know, doing nothing. But anyway, so that's one thing that shows basically the way you can, you know, put models together. Let me mention, and then I'll talk more about it next class before concluding the course. Let me mention that when you have this LDA model, then the last thing you need to do is doing inference. There is no learning because we're doing Bayesian learning, which means inference. Just doing inference, okay? Inference can be done in all sorts of ways. You can, of course, you can do maximum likelihood estimation, which would be non-Bayesian way of doing things, but that would look like almost PLSA. That's why Hoffman is the guy who did BLS. Okay, and if you want to keep the Bayesian, that means you want to keep the priors or the Dirichlet priors over the distributions, then the problem is exact inference is intractable because of those continuous variables. Okay, and mixture of continuous and discrete variables there. And so you can do deterministic approximations, which is a whole class of algorithms we didn't talk about. You can do sampling-based approximations. Sampling we talked about. And in particular, the one that we are interested in is Markov chain Monte Carlo and Gibbs sampling. And no, I'll skip over this. I want you to remember that Markov chain Monte Carlo essentially, I mean, the Gibbs sampling essentially samples a node given all other nodes. So you start, you basically you are sampling in the space of complete assignments over all variables. Complete assignments are over all variables. Now in this particular case, you already know sprinkler and wet grass, they were true. So those are evidence variables. So in every sample, they will always be true. And then you would sample cloudy based on sprinkler, wet grass, rain. You'll sample rain based on cloudy, sprinkler and wet grass. And you keep sampling these. And when you are sampling these, you need to know what is the conditional probability of rain given everybody else. That would be conditional probability of rain given its Markov blanket. It's all coming back hopefully, Markov blanket. A Markov blanket for rain would be its children, its parent, and its children's other parent. So unfortunately for rain, the Markov blanket is the entire network. Whereas for cloudy, the Markov blanket is just sprinkler and rain. And there is a general way of computing the conditional distribution of a node given its entire Markov blanket. That is this. You take the probability of the node given its parents. That can be read off from the CPTs. And then you multiply it by, for each child, probability of the node given the, sorry, the probability of xi given the parents of xi, and for each child, probability that child takes that value given its parents. Okay, all of these can be read directly from the CPTs that are present in the Bayes network. We are still doing Bayes networks, in case anybody is keeping track. Okay, LDA is just a really bad looking Bayes network. Okay, and in particular, I want you to go back and say, well, you can see this, but you can also, my Android version. Yeah, that's the Bayes network that you have. Okay, in this, you know all the words. You don't get to change the words. Okay, then doing Gibbs sampling would be sampling Z4 given everybody else's value. And then sampling Z3 given everybody else's value. Then sampling alpha, this is not the correct, yeah, this is the one that we looked at. Sampling theta given everybody else's value. Sampling beta given everybody else's value, and so on. Okay, that's your Gibbs sampling. You can do this. That's fine. Just a second. Okay. The one interesting point to know is that the collapse Gibbs sampling essentially says I can marginalize the theta and beta. Just a second. I can basically, when I marginalize, theta goes away, so the connections directly go from alpha to z's. This looks, well, some of you should feel bad about this, because we put interior nodes to reduce the number of parameters. Yeah, that's fine, but now we'll remove them. Because we can always compute, this already gives us the factorization. And when you marginalize, you essentially will be thinking in terms of completely discrete variables. Because you have W's, which are discrete variables, Z's, which are discrete variables. And you sample Z, given all W's and the rest of the Z's. Now, where do you get the first set of Z's? Just make them up. Z's are the topics, right? There are 1 to K topics. So Z1, I'll make it 1, Z2, 2, Z3, 3, etc., for example. I can do it that way. And then I can keep resampling Z's given the rest of the Z's. And notice there's nobody else I care about because words are not going to change. Words are already there. Okay? So what I want to show is a picture and then we'll come back. You know, maybe the paper will make more sense to you with this little background and then we'll talk a little more next class. If you can understand it at this level, then we could have done a lot more. Anyway, so level meeting the speed. But anyway, so here is a picture. Okay, this is our original example that I showed you, two topic example with only these words. You started the LDA, you know the words, first word is mathematics, second word is knowledge, third word is research, etc. And the first word is in the document one, and by this time, this word is in the document two. The whole thing is a big, you know, soup, you know, because it's a corpus. Some words are in document one, some are in document two, and so on. Okay? So I have these words. And in the first iteration, I'll set Z's to any value I want. So I just said 2, 2, 1, 1, because there only would need two topics, essentially. Just arbitrarily set. Then I essentially have to figure out, for the second iteration, I need to sample every other variable. Now, W's will never be sampled. Only Z's need to be sampled. So to sample Z1, I essentially use this distribution. The good thing about this distribution is it only asks you for numbers about how many times did a word occur in a topic. How many times did a word occur in every topic other than this topic? How many times did a word occur in this document? Using this is a no-brainer. Checking this is correct is much more interesting. Okay? So using this basically doesn't require, notice that all the gamma functions disappeared. And the reason they disappear is because of that. Gamma is actually a continuous factorial and it gets cancelled out. Okay? So using this, I know that it's proportional to this. If I have a proportionality, then I get the numbers and I can renormalize them to get the real distribution. And then with respect to that real distribution, I have to sample. And I will get for each of the time, I have to recompute the distribution and sample that z value. And then I would get the z values for the second iteration, third iteration, fourth iteration, up to 1,000 iterations. Then I feel that my chain has burned in, it has stabilized. If I feel so, then I take from 1,000 all the way up to next 1,000. These would be samples that will tell me exactly what is the topic distribution over the words. Given those numbers, I can compute PZ given W. That's all I ever wanted. Once I get PZ given W, that is PH given data. Old, the very beginning of the Bayesian learning, P hypothesis given data. You know always what is data given hypothesis. That's just obvious. P hypothesis given data is what you're trying to compute here. And that is, you know, computed this way using something. Okay, I'll stop here. Please look at the paper more. We'll talk a little more next class. And I'll also just end this, you know, the semester.